Let's work through the following word problem together. Annie is texting while driving. Uh-oh. She looks up to see that traffic has stopped in front of her. She slams on the brakes, but is it in time? Annie was traveling at a speed of 45 miles per hour when she slammed on the brakes. She can decelerate at a rate of 22 feet per second squared. If the stopped vehicle is 100 feet in front of her, will Annie be able to stop without causing a wreck? And then hint, consider the moment Annie hits the brakes to be time equals zero. Consider this her starting point. Okay, so what do we have to do to solve this problem? So this is a problem about motion. We have information about acceleration. We have information about velocity. And ultimately, we're looking for information about position, right? We need to know where she is at a certain time so we know whether she hits this vehicle stopped in front of her. So acceleration, position, velocity. There's a relationship between these quantities. So if you remember, if you take the position function and take the derivative of that, the rate of change of the position, that gives you the velocity function. And then in turn, if you take the derivative of the velocity function, that gives you the acceleration function. Now we can go in the opposite direction as well. Okay, if we have the acceleration function and we take its antiderivative, we're going to get the velocity function. Okay, and if we have the velocity function and we take its antiderivative, we're going to get the position function. And that's actually what we're going to have to do in this case, right? Because we're given information about acceleration and about velocity, and we want to get up to that position function. Okay, so what this is actually going to be is what's called an initial value problem. Okay, so let's start with acceleration. Okay, so we know, what do we know about acceleration? Well, we're told she's decelerating at a rate of 22 feet per second squared. So that's my acceleration function. And it's actually going to be negative 22, right? Because she is decreasing her velocity, right? This is deceleration, so the acceleration is negative. Now, if I just went from here, okay, next I want to find the velocity so that I can ultimately get the position function. But if I just went from here and I tried to find the velocity by taking the antiderivative, I would get what we call a general solution. There would be a plus c in there. Well, that's not going to be very helpful because how can I find a specific position if I just have a general solution? So that's where what's called an initial condition comes in. Okay, so if I need to know what the velocity is at time equals zero, right? So acceleration, another way to write this would be that acceleration is the derivative of velocity and I want to find the velocity. So I needed an initial condition for the velocity. And it doesn't even have to be v of 0. It could be v of 1 or v of 2 or just any specific point on the velocity function. But I know v of 0 because we're considering the moment she hits the brakes to be time equals 0, and we know she's traveling at 45 miles per hour at that point in time. So we do know v of 0. Okay, now here's a little bit of an issue because our acceleration is in feet per second squared and our velocity is in 45 miles per hour. So we need to do a unit conversion of one of these. I'm going to go ahead and convert the miles per hour. So let's do that over here. Okay, so how do we convert units? So most of you have probably seen this before, though maybe it's been a while. So 45 miles per hour, I'd like to get that to feet per second. So let's start with the hours. You can kind of think of this as a multiplication problem with canceling out the units. So 1 hour, I'd like those hours to cancel. 1 hour is 3,600 seconds, right? 60 minutes times 60 seconds in an hour. So if I do this, my hours go away, and then I have 45 over 3,600 miles per second. Okay, now I want to get rid of those miles. Okay, so 1 mile is 5,280 feet. Okay, so my miles go away, and I have 45 times 5,280 over 3,600, and that is feet per second. And if you work that out, you end up actually getting 66 feet per second. Okay, so then, when she hits the brake, she's going at a velocity of 66 feet per second. Okay, now this is going to be enough information for us to find a particular velocity function. So let's see what that looks like. So then velocity, we said, was going to be the antiderivative of acceleration. Okay, so I'm doing the indefinite integral of negative 22. So what does that give me? Well, it gives me negative 22t plus c, and I'm going to use my initial condition to solve for c. Okay? So I know then that when time equals 0, velocity is 66, so I just plug in that information. So 66 equals negative 22 times 0 plus c. So c equals 66. So then my velocity function is negative 22t plus 66. Okay, let's start that. We'll definitely need to use that in the future. Okay, so far we have found the velocity function. So that's a good step towards finding the position function, which is what we want to do next. And we're going to do that the exact same way, really. Velocity is the derivative of the position function, right? So we have this, p prime of t is v of t, and we just found that to be negative 22t plus 66. So I'm going to want to take the antiderivative of this velocity function to find the position. But once again, I need some sort of initial condition in order that I can get a particular solution. So I need p of 0. Okay, so remember that we're considering when she hits the brakes to be the starting point. So if you kind of think of her along a line here, right, here's the stopped car. And, you know, here's where Annie hits the brakes. Here's her car, A for Annie. What we can do is we can consider that to be position 0, right? And then she's going to go along this line, and then we'll, and this car is at 100. So we'll see if she can stop in time. Anyway, what I'm saying is that we can call P of 0, 0, right? That's her starting point. Okay, so we have our derivative and our initial condition. So once again, let's go through that antiderivative process. So the position function is the antiderivative of this velocity function. Okay. Remember, from our antiderivative rules, we can think about this term by term. So if you want to split it up like this, you can. Okay. And then can even go ahead and pull out that constant as well, if that's helpful. Okay, so negative 22. T, if we take the antiderivative, that's going to be t squared over 2. And then 66, its antiderivative is 66t. And then we have our plus c. So if we clean that up a little, that's negative 11 t squared plus 66t plus c. Okay, now once again, we want to solve for c. So far, we just have a general solution. We'd like to have a particular solution. So position is 0 when time is 0. Okay, so position is 0 when time is 0. Okay, so I'm plugging in, and I see that c must equal 0. So then, my position function is negative 11 t squared plus 66t plus 0. So that's just it right there. Okay, so we now know the position function, which is great. But we still actually have to answer the question. So let's see how to use now these pieces of information to figure out the answer to the problem. So if I scroll back up, let's review what we're asked for. So we know that the stopped vehicle is 100 feet in front of her. And we want to know, given her, you know, acceleration and velocity, if she's going to be able to stop in time without hitting that car. So how am I going to use the information I've found to do that? So what do I have? I have an acceleration function, a velocity function, and a position function. But let's look at this position function. Okay. Just this position function isn't really enough to answer the question, right? I need a little bit more information, because really what I want to know is I want to know the time when her car stops. And then I want to know her position at that time. Okay, the position she's at when her car stops. Okay, so we need to know Annie's position when her car stops. Okay, well, her car stopping, that's equivalent to her velocity being zero. Okay, so really what we want to know is what is t, or what is the time when velocity equals zero? And remember our velocity function that we found, we can use it to answer this question. Okay, so we found that velocity was negative 22 t plus 66. And we'd like to know when that's zero. Okay, so I'm solving zero equals negative 22 t plus 66. Okay, so I get 22t equals 66. T equals 66 over 22, which is 3. Okay, so then it takes 3 seconds for her car to come to a stop. Okay, so now what I can do is evaluate her position at 3 seconds. Okay, so then P of 3. Okay, so P of t is negative 11. T squared plus 66, and I want to know P of 3, so negative 11 times 3 squared plus 66. Okay, so that's a negative 11 times 9 plus 66, so negative 99 plus 66. All right, this should be 62t. Sorry about that. I was wondering why this is coming out a little funny. Okay, so 66t from our position function up here, right? So that's there. And I will just tell you, if you plug this into your calculator, then you should get 99 as the position. Okay, so what does that tell us? It tells us that when Annie's car stops, she has gone 99 feet. Okay, so then if we scroll back up, where was that other car? The other car was at 100 feet. Okay, so she just barely makes it. So she does avoid hitting the other car, but barely. Okay, so then the moral here, of course, is the relationship between position, velocity, and acceleration, and also not to text while driving.